extremely old, so there's demand, big news, right? The next category, so as cool as the BLS is, they don't have a category for data science yet, because it's not official, I don't know what the heck. If anybody does know, really quick technical note, the difference between a statistician and a data scientist, it's about 10 to 15 grand a year. And allegedly data scientists can code, although not as all of you know all too well, not all of them can. The interesting over here is that it's growing at twice the rate of developer jobs. So it's pretty good to be a developer right now, but if you're a statistician, and this particular job description didn't even include a lot of code, the numbers are almost growing by 50%, and they might continue to grow more. This is probably a conservative projection based on the growth of data right now. Once companies know what the hell they're doing with data scientists, there's a lot of growth potential. But interestingly enough, I go on Glassdoor, I put in data scientist, expecting to find tons of jobs and rainbows and unicorns, and it's a little more than full stack developer, whatever the heck that means. So this was a little puzzling. I thought, yeah, maybe the growth isn't there, but I kept going around, and I got this. Data engineer. How many people have looked specifically for a data engineer job? I got one hand. 100,000 different jobs popped up. Now, it would be very ironic if I said this was like a scientific survey, a data science talk, so let's do some data science. Most of the numbers I'm going to throw at you really quickly. If you have any numbers or any questions, please ask afterwards. Also, if you have numbers, that would be cool. The number of data engineers doubled like 4 years ago, 13 between 15. 42% of data engineers were software engineers. And in one sense, you're like, okay, cool, I'm a software engineer, it makes my graduation easy. But this is less than half. So there's a 50% roughly of these people are coming from a completely different background, which begs the question what that background is. One more stat just to show off how freaking insane this is. If we took everyone on LinkedIn right now who called themselves a data engineer, they couldn't fill all the positions in San Francisco. There's a bunch of more figures on demand. Let me just jump right into it. So what are these data engineers? So the cool part, I wrote a web scraper, two web scrapers, that went and got the skills from job descriptions, from tags, from very anonymous websites, because I read their terms of service and they're like, don't scrape our data. Credit, but they never got back to me on the emails. If you really want to know what websites they are, you can go to the Denver Dev Slack. I'm asking about if it's legal, and so. Well, what did I find? These were the top skills on pretty much. These are all ubiquitous: SQL, Python, Java, and even Linux. I want to really emphasize that these are in order: in Python, beat out Java. I don't know if that's relevant. Hadoop. I put a little asterisk next to because Hadoop is extremely common because people know that's a cluster manager. When I talk to the cluster manager community, a lot of times they're like, yeah, Hadoop's great, it's a fine skill. So learn these, but there's also Mesos, there's Spark, which is taking a Hadoop's butt according to my data science friends. I don't know. Good things to learn, good things to write down for the future. But really building into my main point here. So machine learning was mentioned more often than NoSQL. The temptation with the data engineer, especially for software developers, go, yeah, I need to be a good SQL backend guy. But machine learning was more common. So actual statistics skill sets and living in the world of the data scientist is becoming an extremely important skill. That's an adorable red panda. Everybody say aw. Thank you. Pandas is a niche library in Python that handles statistical analysis. I will very much defend the opinion that if you don't understand statistics, Pandas is going to seem pointless. It's just going to seem like an ORM. But it's extremely powerful. Most data scientists know it. And yet, for a data engineer, one of the most common skills that's listed was this niche library, Pandas. So cool. So we just have to learn a bunch of technology, right? But here's two quick more quotes that kind of prove my point. The Galvanize CTO, and I'm not a Galvanize grad, so this is not total bias. Think about the relationship between designers and front-end developers. One comes up with the idea, the other implements. How many just love working with a designer that hates code and doesn't want to talk about code? Awesome, right? They're freaking annoying, and it's the other way around. So every designer I meet that talks with a developer with no eye for design and doesn't think they need an eye for design suffers. But the teams that are really synergetic and powerful are ones that live in both worlds, and it's going to be the same with data analysis. Another quote, data engineer or director at HuffPo, a lot of companies separate the data platform from the data science team. I took the job at Huffington Post because they gave me the authorization to tear down that wall. So cool. So this is all we need to learn, if anyone wants to take a shot. The good and bad thing about data science that makes it really interesting for software engineers and not just data scientists is that this is the technology, and I'm pretty sure a couple of those are already like deprecated or backwards. What do we really need to learn? I got to make this talk way earlier, this is going to be awesome. So, up now. I would argue, especially talking with data scientists and people who have been in that context and are affected in that context, mean, median, and standard deviation. Who remembers high school? Come on. It's funny though because I talk to developers and they talk about, okay, yeah, I guess I need to go learn Hadoop, I need to go learn TensorFlow, I need to go, and I don't think you actually understand what's going on in those advanced ones if you don't understand these concepts very well. So literally, if you're interested in becoming a data engineer as I am, go back to Khan Academy, go to high school stat, get your head around these concepts and how you would program them into like a Python script or something like that. I also need to say Python. Absolutely learn Python. It's not as fast as a lot of the compiled languages. It has the GIL. The creator looks kind of like a nerd. I have a picture of him on here. But it's an incredibly easy language. It's it will take you no time at all if you've learned anything harder. And yet, statisticians the world around are starting to use it, even in the academic community, which they move as slow as freaking molasses. So Python's really one of the only technologies I want to harp on. Learn regression. I might get a data scientist destroying me after this for saying this, but if you understand a regression and you understand the concepts between model complexity versus predictive power, you are already in the data scientist world. I'm not saying you're going to go off and get a job as a data scientist, but when they start talking, it's going to sound less like jargon, and it's going to sound like, okay, like I get where you're at. And as a developer, I can give you a real solution as opposed to just throwing data at you. This is a cool little graph. This screen is way too small to really see it. Something as simple as this. This is really just a regression and explains the trade-off between model complexity using R-squared. I'm not intending for you to understand it necessarily right now, but this will be available afterward. And there's a lot of cool graphics that really make this very easy for a software developer to pick up. And then, of course, you can barely see them, but random forests and neural nets. One of the most interesting things that I was actually just talking about this with a friend before, neural nets and TensorFlow and this intense stuff is really cool, and I would suggest playing with it because it's fun, but there's a data scientist that gives a lot of talks at these kind of mixed conferences where there's a little data and a little development, who's always talking about those things, and I'll ask him afterward, how did you apply that in work? And he's like, don't ask me that publicly, because everyone at work is scared of those things, and I need things that are much more simple. And as much as it's kind of a bummer, that's also kind of cool, because it means he's doing things developers can get their head around and be effective and contribute to. Last but not least, if some of you are still a little unsure about really getting into data and making that a part of your learning track and a part of your life, this is a great way to find out. So the first link, and always let us tweet this out, is a talk called Statistics Hackers. It was one of the most popular talks at PyCon. It is straightforward, it uses a lot of code, and very simple, almost like fifth grader examples of data science. And by the end, you feel like you're actually not so much that you could do all these complex models, but you understand their world so much better afterward. If you like that talk, same speaker does another one, and then there's another two that you should look at. This last one I actually threw on last night, and it was about, it was a talk at Berkeley about bridging that gap between these two cultures and how when we're divided as the data science team and analysis team and the data engineering or pipeline team, when we're divided, and to put it frankly, it's easy for business people to manipulate us because we demand one thing from one team and then they complain about the other team and this team complains to the business about it. When we're united and we actually see data analysis as a technology skill set, we have an incredible incredible amount of bargaining power to drive the company in the direction you want to take it. Other than that, if you're already interested but need some help getting started, this is a link to where you can go with Pandas, TensorFlow, Jupyter, and a couple of other things. Two quick things I wanted to point out, as much as Python's pretty much the bomb, if you can tell. I think that Scala, if you live in the Java world, the Java community has been very excited about this language. It's not quite as syntactic and clear as Python, but it's more functional, so they're getting a little bit better speeds when you're doing ETL. And then surprisingly, Node has a couple of libraries and a couple of ways for you to get started. I'm going to jump back up here. Yeah, so long story short, when I first set out to get into tech because I needed money, I told some people about my background. I had econometrics, I had statistics, but then I also thought building websites was really cool. And I was originally told, well, you know, spend a couple of months figuring out which one you want to do and then pick. And I think that's probably the worst advice I've ever gotten, and I'm not going to follow. Yeah, any questions? So I'll say two things. One, R is awesome. It is a good way to trick an academic into doing code because they often, more often than not, you introduce it to the LightStater, like MATLAB. Even my mom uses R, which is pretty cool. The one thing I'll say about R is it's controversial, but I really feel like Python's going to take it over. There's just so many things that when I watch someone build an R script, I'm like, yeah, do this exact same thing in Python. But it's going to take freaking forever because of especially academia.
I wonder if you noticed this, like how many postings for a data engineer, data scientist require a master's degree?
Very few. Surprisingly. So I'll index that to if I was hiring a data engineer, I would love a master's degree because not to hit on the boot camps, not to hit on the self-taught people, I'm self-taught programming. When it comes to statistics, there are theoretical concepts that if you don't get, it's very hard to communicate your model correctly. So a master's degree is a good idea. I didn't see it on a lot of these descriptions. And that's using a scraper, so I might have to reprogram the scraper and take a look at it, but it was not nearly as common as it thought it would be. My plan right now, which will get screwed up by life probably, would be to get a master's degree while being a software developer that focuses more on statistics. But that's, again, that's me wanting the theory.
Machine learning, if you have data engineering jobs or data engineering, you're the one that's controlling all the machine learning.
Yes. A data engineer that understands and can turn machine learning into business insights. So think of this from the business guy's perspective. This is so freaking over their heads. Most of them. Oh, if you're a founder that understands this, don't mind them. But for a lot of them, this is so completely over their heads. If you can take machine learning, even as just an engineer, and not a pure statistician, and say, this is what that insight is supposed to be telling us, you're going to be around for a long time. If, on the other hand, you know how to make TensorFlow work without errors, but there's no way to communicate with the rest of your team what it's doing, I would consider that a little precarious. So, ML is nowhere close to eating up these actual jobs, though. Because every data scientist I talk with knows how to do it and gets a chance to do it maybe once if their company is huge. Because business people like to know naturally what the heck people are up to, and if you can't make that insight obvious and quick, they're going to say, okay, stick to these simpler models like regressions, Cartesians, other fancy words, but not as complicated as something like ML. You're going to put it back.
How would you prioritize your data skill sets if you're putting a team together? What role would you hire first, second, third?
So I would hire, actually it's funny you ask that. So this is a very different answer now that I've worked at a startup for about, not quite a year. I would first hire a product owner. I would get someone who knows how to get with a client and just talk about what they want in fourth grade or fifth grade terms. Then I would hire developers, get the core product out there, and then I would try to hire the engineer and the scientist at once. I don't think at a big or even a mid-sized company you can get them in one person, because like I said, this is, if you spend your life studying statistics and become really good, you'll have some code, but you're not going to be a DevOps data guy. So I would hire both of them. I would want to make sure they got along. I don't know if I could do something weird, like interview them together or something, be like, friends. But that's essentially the order I would build it. You start with core product, because one of the biggest things, you know, I interviewed a data scientist before I actually got into tech, and she was hired at a startup, and by the time we got together for coffee, she was fired. Because they didn't know how to use her. She comes on and they say, okay, tell us data. And she goes, you need to have a question to answer. So I guess one of the main points of this talk is developers need to have their head around data scientists, data science, because they need to be communicating to the business and constantly, we need a good question to answer before we really start getting new statistics. Anyone else want to come at me with regressions?
So and that's the big point I was trying to formulate questions like, what do data engineers do?
A data engineer, what they do, so it's interesting, if I was describing this just in raw terms, they ETF. They get data, they clean it, they scrape it, they should be mining it more often. I didn't see data mining listed as a skill very often, but I personally think that's a mistake, like you need to be a good miner. They get the data ready to do data science on. Now, the temptation there is to say, oh, so it's just a good backend engineer. But statistics can get so complicated, and without those core principles, your understanding can be so far off that you're not going to really be doing that, even though you think you're doing that as a data engineer, if you just have a traditional backend background. Whereas if you can have a conversation, what a data engineer really does, especially if I'm talking to like a lawyer, is they have a conversation with the data scientist about what they truly need. In the same way a front-end engineer and a designer that just dumps a wireframe at you and goes, make this, is boring for a couple of reasons, not the least of which is like, okay, I don't know what's easy and what's hard and what's realistic. So I would say a data engineer in all this detail, in all this back-end development, is someone who can have a real and effective conversation with their data science team, with their statistician team, and go back and do that informed by what they actually need. Does that make sense?
Kind of. Maybe you could explain what you actually
did. Oh, I'm not a data engineer. If I was an economist, so right now I'm just a back-end developer. I'm too small to get my head around this yet, but what I have recently told my family is that when we hire a data scientist, the first thing I'm going to do is find out, is he a Bayesian or a frequentist? How does he approach a general problem with data? What does he need to know? How does he get to asking that right question? How does he justify a model? Those are all questions that with a bachelor's in economics and you know a couple of YouTube videos and some practice, I can understand. And that will completely change the way I approach the way I collect the data. So if he's a frequentist, numbers are freaking everything. We need to get a lot of data, we need to approach that hard. Whereas he's amazing, he tweaks his model and kind of answer different questions, then that changes my approach a little bit. But I have to be very sure about what data I'm getting, what it means, and things like that. So, yeah, I have a real conversation with a data scientist that involves me as a sort of junior statistician, type word, and build my app that way, oriented around data. Because so many of these data scientists come to these teams and they're like, okay, where's the data? And someone's like, we thought you had it. And that's very aspectful to me.
So what kind of size do you think a company should think about, like, actually getting, you know, the data science, the data engineer, versus just a robust backend engineer? And, like, is there a point where it's necessary?
That deeply depends on the company. So a company doing like Bitcoin, Ethereum, anything very data intensive, try to find a guy that's pretty good at both. That's probably a little more engineer oriented. Figure out how much data drives your product. For us, for like senior Python developer, but you are still software development at this point. And the conversation I've had with my founder is like, okay, once we have a big set of data, And once our product owner can ask, right now our product owner is literally asking people, do you use this? That does not require regression, that requires yes or no. But eventually our product owner is going to want to know, is a 23-year-old female biology major more likely to use this than a 50-year-old engineering major? Like, that's a question where you actually have to start reading those. And so get your core business questions out. Start with the engineer before the scientist. And then once those core questions become a little complicated and interesting, then start to feed into data scientists. But who needs sleep, right? Spend all your time going to meetups and getting to know people, and you'll find that this is a very blurry line, and that's an awesome thing. Because people are just interested in multi-line. That's about the time. I can take one more, do you know? Hit me up after you. I'm going to tweet these out. I'm also going to put them on the Develop Denver Slack. Thanks for coming, guys.